let us begin. The first question is, what is marriage? Brian, you want to go first?
Can I just yield my time? It would be less work.
Okay,
so I'll use my time now. If I have some left over, I'll yield it at the end. All right, so the question, what is marriage? My co-author, one of whom is in the audience this afternoon, Sharif Gurgis, and I, with a professor of ours at Princeton, Robert George, we published a book about 4 or 5 years ago now titled What is Marriage? Man and Woman, a Defense. And in that book, we try to provide a philosophical account of why marriage is a permanent, exclusive, monogamous union of one man and one woman. The analysis that we give there is an understanding that marriage is a comprehensive union. And it's comprehensive in how it unites spouses, in what it unites spouses towards, and in what it demands of spouses. That trifold analysis we get right from Aristotle. Aristotle tells us we can analyze any type of community or society by looking at the actions that the society performs, look at the goods that it is ordered towards, and look at the commitments that it makes to one another. So we said marriage was comprehensive in those three respects, comprehensive in that there's an act that unites spouses comprehensively, unites them at all levels of their humanity. There's going to be an act that unites spouses at the level of hearts, minds, and bodies. And this bodily component matters because we're bodily beings. We're not just ghosts who inhabit machines. We're not just souls that are somehow floating around near a physical body, but we are bodies. And so that bodily union is a personal union. So the first step of this analysis would be, how is it that two people can unite? Two people are going to unite comprehensively if they unite not just hearts and minds, the way that we unite with our friends, with our colleagues. Those are unions of hearts and minds. You don't ordinarily unite bodily with your roommates or with your best friends. The bodily dimension will be distinctive to the marital union. And the question then becomes, how do we unite bodily? If I lick my finger and stick it in your ear, have we united comprehensively bodily, or have I given you a wet willy? Most people are going to suggest the latter, not the former. So it's not just that two individuals interlock, or they rub up, or they somehow touch. What is it that makes them one flesh in the way that the Hebrew scriptures discuss this? We think that the Hebrew scriptures there are revealing something that's true about human nature at the physical and the metaphysical level. When a man and a woman unite in the conjugal act, they truly become one flesh. They don't just rub up or interlock or touch one another, they actually become a single entity. So the Hebrew scriptures there aren't just saying the two become one flesh in the sense that they're so far in love, it's as if they become one flesh, but they actually form a dynamic unity. A single entity, and the way of illustrating this, and what we do in the book is to say that in all respects, we're united as a single individual. Consider anything that you do, whether it's digestion, locomotion, respiration, circulation, all of us are doing those things right now on our own. Our hearts are pumping, our blood's circulating. If you had lunch earlier, you're digesting it. If you're breathing right now, you're respiring, and then it's giving oxygenated blood circulating through your heart. Individuals, locomotion will all walk out of here when we're done. There's a single action that we can perform that we're radically incomplete to do as an individual. There's one function that can take place, one action that we can perform that requires another person. So that when the two unite in the conjugal action, they truly become one entity with respect to the act of procreation. Regardless of whether 24 hours later a sperm fertilizes an egg, regardless of whether 9 months later a child is born, that the action itself is what unites one man and one woman comprehensively as husband and wife. And that comprehensive act then tells us something about the good that marriage is ordered towards. It's ordered towards a comprehensive good, both the creation and then the rearing of new human life. Most human relationships aren't intrinsically ordered towards creating new life or raising new life. You and your roommates, your teammates, your classmates, there's no reason why you guys should be adopting kids and raising kids. There's nothing about that relationship that orders it towards this. There is something about the marital relationship that gives it this dynamism, that gives it this orientation. Because the lovemaking act is also the life-giving act. The act that makes a man and a woman husband and wife is the same exact act that makes them mother and father. So what makes marriage unique from other relationships is, first, there's a comprehensive act that spouses engage in. Second, there's a comprehensive good that they're ordered towards. And then third, they make comprehensive commitments to each other. First, a comprehensive commitment throughout time pledge of permanency. Now, most of you haven't made that commitment to your freshman year roommate. You're not expected to live with that person till death do you part. Most of you won't make that sort of a commitment to your first boss, to your first colleagues and coworkers. You will make that sort of a commitment to your spouse. The type of commitment that marriage requires is going to be a permanent commitment throughout time. And then lastly, an exclusive commitment. It's comprehensive at every moment in time. You forsake all others. And it's exclusive with respect to that conjugal act, that marital act, because that's the action that's distinctive of marriage. Anyway.
Pastor Turley.
Can you hear me? Hello? Oh, we probably don't need it. Okay, that's good. I'm half Italian, so I speak loudly, and I can't stand behind a podium and speak at the same time, but I just move my hands wildly. Thank you very much for having me. It's a great pleasure to be here with Ryan, who I have a great deal of respect for. So much respect, in fact, that I will agree with everything he just said, as long as he makes it applicable to everyone in our nation. I agree with him entirely that marriage is about creating a comprehensive commitment. It's about receiving some type of, quote, good. It's about making individuals who join together and they become one. All of that is incredibly accurate, incredibly true, incredibly profound. I just don't want to deny it to a significant portion of our population. When you ask what marriage is, it is what we say it is as a nation. Now, I say that not to disregard religious definitions of marriage, to the contrary. I think that what you say marriage is equally valid. It's just that I expect in this room we will have very different views of what constitutes marriage. I just don't want the government making that decision. I am unabashedly libertarian. I don't like the government entering our bedrooms. I don't like the government telling us what morality is officially correct. What is the moral relationship that will be recognized? I view history in a different way. I think history, if it says anything at all, is about the triumph of individual rights, the right of people to make decisions, the right of government to protect that right, not to answer that decision for us. It's a movement towards pluralism. And so, yes, there's two different views here about that history. Ironically, we share the same view about marriage. I've been happily married to my wife, Leslie, for, a long time. We have four kids and a large dog and an incredibly dysfunctional family, which we love. That is our view of marriage. I represent people out west who define marriage in a different way. I will note, in the Sister Wives case, we are not arguing for the recognition of plural marriage. We are arguing against the criminalization of plural marriage and relationships. But if you want to find out what marriage means, you go back to the 18th century in England, where the early marriage laws were defined as someone who was married by the Anglican Church. So if whether you were Christian or non-Christian, you had to be married by an Anglican minister, or you were not recognized as marriage. And we hear them, we say, oh my lord, no pun intended, that's outrageous. That means a Catholic can't be married, or a Jewish family can't be married. And we look at that, and we have a sense of revulsion. But do we have enough dispassion, enough objectivity, to see how it is equally perverse to tell two people who are loved, who are maybe of the same sex, that no, you're not really married. That's for me to decide. That's for the majority to decide. We don't approve of your relationship. There is an alternative way, of course. Everything Ryan said can be fully enforced in each of our individual lives. It was enforced in my life. Look, we had a Jewish Catholic wedding. We covered the bases. The rapture occurs, I'm standing near my kids because they're covered. We had a rabbi, we had a priest, and that satisfied our religious beliefs. But the solution, in my view, is to allow us each to make that decision, to have the marriage that we feel resonates with our faith, with each other. I've often argued that the definition of marriage is twofold. One is how society defines it, and that is as a legal obligation. That's what a marriage license is. That's the reason I argued years ago we should all have civil unions, because the only interest of the state is that we have made a contractual obligation to each other, that we are responsible for each other, that we can be held accountable for each other. That's the only interest of the government. That's the only role I want the government to play in my life. And then you can be married, which is a religious term, as we did, with a priest or a rabbi, with a mullah, whatever you want, with a public employee. Whatever you want in terms of that personal choice as to marriage, you can make. But there's a triumphant history that is building. And I would suggest my friend Ryan is missing out on that opportunity to embrace the triumph of individual rights and to allow each of us to have the relationship and the faith that we think is correct.
Thank you, Professor Turley. Next question. Why or why not should consenting adults be the moral and or legal standard for marriage? Professor Turley, you start.
Cool. I have a rather particular way of looking at this question, which is why I brought my law review article, which I will clearly abuse. I wrote a piece recently on marriage, both plural and monogamous marriage. And what I suggested is that this decision should be answered under the utilitarian principles of John Stuart Mill and Jeremy Bentham. For those of you who may be a little more libertarian, you'll be familiar with that. But let me read you what Mill said, which became known as the harm principle. Okay? And in my view, this is one of the most profound things ever written. The sole end for which mankind are warranted, individually and collectively, interfering with the liberty of action of any of their number is self-protection. That the only purpose for which power can be rightfully exercised over any member of a civilized community against his will is to prevent harm to others. That became known as the harm principle, and it's one that I fully embrace. That the role of government is to prevent us from harming each other, not in a moral sense. It preserves to us the greatest range of individual choice to create the lives that we feel bring us closer to God, or bring us closer to the values that we cherish. I think that the reason marriage needs to be defined by individuals is because we are not harmed when two people of the same sex are married. You may find it offensive, you may even find it grotesque, but that's not a harm, that's a moral objection. And the government should not be in the role of enforcing moral codes. Just because you're in the majority doesn't give you the right to say, this is the morality by which you shall live by. Why? Because we think it's correct, because it's found in the Bible, or it's found in my faith. You would never accept that if another faith was to dictate a different moral code to you. That's the reason I think that as a nation we've come to a mature point where we realize that allowing people to make choices doesn't mean that our choice is belittled. It doesn't mean that our relationships are not valid. We've come to a mature point where we can say, yes, people can live their lives, have their relationships. We can recognize them legally as obligated to each other. And it doesn't diminish our rights, it expands it. That's the reason I think that I'm arguing for morality here, not just privacy, because I want to protect everyone's moral choices. I just don't want to dictate the answer for each and every one of you. And when we protect everyone's moral choices, we're more of a moral nation, not less. Because before, when we only had this requirement that your marriage had to look exactly the way I think it should look, it gave the appearance of uniformity, but it wasn't uniform. We just forced people below the surface. We forced them into hiding. There were homosexuals back then, right? You know, they didn't just spring from the head of Zeus. They didn't just were created suddenly in the last 10 years. They were always there, but they were hiding. So we didn't have this perfect moral society, and those moral codes didn't produce any change in people except to coerce them to look and sound like us. So maybe we've reached this moment as a society where we can let everyone's morality flourish We can say we're a moral country because we let you choose your morality. Because we're living at a time when extremists are executing people because they don't follow the rules that they believe are morally right. And we represent the answer to that. We represent strength through pluralism. That we believe we're all moral beings and that we all have a path to choose. That's part of being a human being, is at the end of the day, you are your greatest creation, your life. It's not how many buildings you can build, how many cases you can win. You are your greatest creation. And I think that you should be allowed to define that, to pursue that in the way that you feel is necessary. And that includes picking who it is you want to spend your life with. And so what I would submit to my friend Ryan is we can actually have the best of all worlds. I'll fight to the death to protect his right to define his marriage according to his church. As long as we fight for everyone's right to make the same decision.
Great. So a couple things to say. First, the first question was, what is marriage? And we didn't hear an answer to that question. What we heard instead was that marriage is whatever you want it to be. Marriage is a choose-your-own-adventure novel. There's no right or wrong answer. There's not even no right or wrong answer. There are not even better or worse or philosophical accounts of what marriage is. It's almost as if you read The Republic and you hear Socrates asking, well, what's justice? And you hear Thrasymachus saying, well, it's whatever the majority says. It's whatever the strongest says. It's whatever those who are in power say. No, if you actually want to defend morality and pluralism, it needs to be based on something. And so for the founders, it was based on natural rights. It was based on certain inalienable rights. There were certain self-evident truths. And it's not that we have to run away from truth in order to protect pluralism and liberty and freedom. We actually need to have a foundation for those values that we hold. And so it can't be freedom is whatever it is that you say it is, morality is whatever it is that you say it is, justice is whatever it is that you say it is. We actually have to talk about those concepts. We actually have to defend the correct understanding of what liberty is and what justice is. Because one man's liberty is another man's license. The million harm principle only works if we can actually have a definition of what counts as a harm. And we can't say, well, harm is whatever it is that we say it is. Right? This just becomes circular refutation. So we didn't get an answer to the first question of what marriage is. Instead, we got an answer to the second question twice. Both the first time and the second time, is that people should be free to do whatever they want to do when it comes to marriage. And of course, they could, even before the Supreme Court redefined marriage. Marriage laws didn't impact anyone's liberty. So when Professor Turley says, I wish my friend Ryan would agree, he doesn't have to wish. Marriage laws don't infringe on anyone's liberty to live how they want to, or to love how they want to, or as he said, to pick who it is they want to live with. What was at stake here wasn't a liberty right. What was at stake here was the government definition of marriage. Who was eligible for government regulation? And so it's very odd for a libertarian to say that he wants the government to redefine what marriage is so it can regulate more consenting adult love lives. It's just a very odd argument to run on libertarian grounds. Because what we had before, and what we still have now, because even the clients that he's defending, they actually are under a criminal sanction, that they can't live and love how they want to. But he said himself that he's not arguing that they should have their plural marriages recognized in law. So even earlier, Professor Turley has identified the distinction between something that actually sanctions your liberty, infringes upon your liberty, and something that merely leaves your consenting adult relationship of your choice unregulated by the government. So it's unclear how on libertarian grounds he gets from it's not being regulated by the government to I have a constitutional right to it being regulated. What is the harm here, if you look at this from a million perspective? The harm here is what I articulated in the Philadelphia Inquirer op-ed on Valentine's Day. Right now, we have 40% of all American children being born to single mothers. It's 50% of Hispanic children. It's over 70% of African Americans. Gays and lesbians aren't to blame for that. Heterosexuals are. Heterosexuals who bought into Professor Turley's understanding of what marriage is, where marriage is whatever consenting adults want it to be. So the problem here is that when consenting adults live out the J.S. Mill philosophy of marriage, where it's whatever we want it to be, whether it's between two, three, or more consenting adults, whether it's a sexually exclusive or a sexually open relationship, whether it's a temporary relationship or a permanent relationship, the consequence is that we have more and more children who are growing up outside of a relationship with their married mother and father. So the only grounds, from a limited government perspective, that the state takes an interest in marriage is not because it's a sucker for your love life. We don't have government in the marriage business because it cares about what you do in your bedroom. We have government in the marriage business because a certain type of sexual act between a man and a woman, can produce a child, and that child deserves both a mother and a father, and that when this doesn't happen, either because a marriage never forms in the first place, or because a marriage falls apart prematurely due to divorce or abandonment, the consequences for those children, for those mothers, for those communities are drastic. And all you have to do is compare any two neighborhoods in the same city. Compare two neighborhoods in Philadelphia. I don't know what there will be called here. In DC, it's Anacostia and it's Georgetown. In Georgetown, the vast majority of those children are being raised by their married mothers and fathers. They graduate from school, they go to college, they get jobs, they don't go to jail, they lead flourishing lives. In Anacostia, the majority of those kids are not being raised by their married mothers and fathers. Their graduation rates are lower, their employment rates are lower, their incarceration rates are higher. That's what gets the government involved here, to get one man and one woman to commit permanently and exclusively to one another so that kids have their mother and their father raising them. And we can do that while respecting the liberty of adults to live in other relationships.
Well, we have a slight prudential change here, Brian, is okay. Professor Turley would like to respond directly to that.
Sure.
And then we'll move on to the third question, and you can respond to Professor Turley.
All right, first of all, I just want to make sure you understand what the goods are that you are being sold at this point. What Ryan is talking about is not just confining marriage. He's talking about, well, we need to define marriage in a way to prevent all of these parents that don't have, all these children that don't have parents. I assume you'll mean that you'll also change divorce laws, right? The weird thing is that the divorce laws are largely secular. You can get a divorce if you want one, right? In the Jewish faith, you need a get. You know, you need approval from one party. But we don't say that because we say, look, we don't want to impose a religious definition of divorce. So I assume that not only are we going to deal with divorce now to prevent this so-called runaway society of children without parents, but we'll impose a series of religious-based rules to create a better society. But that's a bit odd, right? Because we have a 50%, roughly 50% divorce rate. I assume a lot of those folks are Judeo-Christian couples. It doesn't seem to be a speed bump in terms of people getting divorces. What it does do, what Ryan is trying to get us back in the business of doing, is to proclaim what marriages we will recognize as moral and what are not. I don't know about who's going to jail in Georgetown versus Anacostia. I expect in Anacostia, one of the reasons you have a lot of people going to jail is it's extremely poor and it's a minority area. In Georgetown, they just go to jail for insider trading, but I don't know what that has to do with marriage, okay? What marriage is about is a legal obligation, and what Ryan said is, why don't you tell us what the harm is, okay? I thought I did, okay? I can tell you what the harm is not. It is not moral harm. That's part of living in a free country. He said, well, how does he define freedom? That would be it again. Freedom means not being required to satisfy the moral dictates of your government, of the majority. That's what freedom is. It's freedom to make a choice. And the idea that, you know, that lacks foundation is simply ignoring the concept of freedom, that moral choices as a whole should be left to individuals to make. Now, by the way, if you go down the road with Ryan, you need to look at reversing Lawrence v. Texas, potentially. You need to look, certainly, at getting rid of Obergefell. But also, you end up with things like Loving. You know, back in Loving, it was decided that it was immoral for whites to marry blacks. Immoral. And in fact, the arguments made in Loving was that these relationships harm children, that they end up as outcasts. It was defended on many of the same arguments Ryan is making now. And we shot down Loving for a very good reason, because it was based on prejudice, it was based on intolerance, it was based on us defining for others what we consider to be appropriate relationships. And we're better because we got rid of Loving. We're also better because we decriminalized in Lawrence v. Texas. Now, in terms of the great problem of my representing for decriminalization as opposed to recognition, the answer is very simple. You see, I think that the government has a right to establish whether we have an enforceable contract of marriage. The government can make a rational basis argument that we can do that with one marriage license, because otherwise you can have people having multiple marriage licenses that creates legal issues. But that can be defended, and that can be answered in court. Can they make a rational basis for saying that multiple marriage licenses create real harm in terms of administrative harm, et cetera? What you can't do is say, look, we're not going to recognize your marriage because you can't procreate. Older people who get married often can't procreate. Some people get married who don't want to have children. And it's rather archaic to suggest that's the basis of marriage. I would hope as a society we've gotten to the point where we actually believe, and this may seem an extraordinarily radical idea, that the thing that makes a marriage is people who love each other, who want to commit to each other, who want to be treated, as Ryan says, as one. Now that doesn't give you a lot of room to dictate who it is that we will allow to make that commitment. But that's the definition of freedom Ryan was looking for.
Great, yeah, so sorry, but they are free. Everyone in America is free to do this, whatever the state defines marriage as. So you can't simply get from a premise about liberty or freedom to any conclusion about the nature of marriage. There's just no logical train that you can travel to get from a premise, an argument based upon adult liberty, to what sort of consenting adult relationship is a marital relationship. We haven't seen it done this afternoon, and we can stay here all night. We won't see it done, because it's simply impossible. The question here is, which among all of the vast variety of consenting adult relationships is a marital relationship? And we have not heard one word this afternoon to answer that question. Second thing, the idea that you don't know what the connection is between poverty in marriage is simply astounding, because the best scholars on both the right and the left have been publishing on this for maybe 40 or 50 years now. So whether you're a libertarian like Charles Murray at the American Enterprise, so whether you're a libertarian like Charles Murray at the American Enterprise Institute, or you're a social liberal like Robert Putnam at Harvard University, both of whom within the past 5 years have published best-selling, New York Times best-selling books about how the breakdown of the American family is the leading driver of poverty, especially within the minority communities. So for the professor to say, I don't know what's causing poverty in Anacostia, perhaps it has something to do with their poor and their racial minorities, but not to see that the connection here is that that's precisely where the family is breaking down the most. And this is something that's not even controversial. Both people on the right and people on the left have identified it. The only question is, what do we actually do to address it? Part of the answer to that question is adequately understanding what it is that has caused the breakdown of marriage in the United States. And part of that is based upon a bad understanding of what marriage is and what it requires of spouses. That's the understanding that we got out of the 60s, the understanding that we got out of the sexual revolution, that love makes a family, that marriage should last as long as the love lasts. These aren't phrases that gays and lesbians gave us. These are phrases that heterosexuals who bought into liberal ideology about sex and marriage gave us. Same-sex couples simply took that ideology, took that logic to its logical conclusion. And so in the Obergefell decision, Anthony Kennedy simply enshrined a bad philosophy of marriage into our Constitution, that marriage is simply about consenting adult romance of whatever size or shape the consenting adults most desire. What does this mean for Lawrence v. Texas? I don't know why he thinks I think that should be overturned. That had to do with criminal prohibitions on consenting adult sexual actions. An entirely separate question from what sort of consenting adult relationship is a marital relationship. They're not even in the same moral universe in terms of the analysis of the liberty interest at stake. How is this at all similar to Loving v. Virginia? Loving v. Virginia was based on something that had nothing to do with marriage. Bans on interracial marriage took something utterly irrelevant to marriage, skin color, and said they were relevant. The Obergefell decision takes something that is central to marriage, sexual complementarity, and says it's irrelevant to marriage. This is why every great thinker in human history, Plato, Aristotle, Augustine, Aquinas, Luther, Calvin, John Locke, Immanuel Kant, Mahatma Gandhi, all said marriage has to be colorblind. None of them said it has to be genderblind. The reason why they said it had to be colorblind is because a man and a woman can unite as one flesh regardless of their race. A man and a woman can create a child regardless of their race. Children deserve a mother and a father regardless of their race. That's why Loving v. Virginia was rightly struck down. It violated equal protection under our laws because it denied real marriages, interracial marriages, real marriages, the protection of law as marriages. The question here is, what sort of a relationship is a real marriage? And only if you answer that question can you then get to any of the questions about what sort of relationship should be recognized in law as a real marriage. And that's what we haven't heard today.
And the final question for this afternoon, though it won't be our final discussion, is the idea of equality in the phrase marriage equality in accord with the principles of human equality and natural rights in the Declaration of Independence as understood by the American founders who wrote the Constitution as well as the Declaration? I have Ryan going first and then Jonathan.
Sure. So what does marriage equality require? Marriage equality requires what other forms of equality require. It says that we treat things that are the same in the same ways. It doesn't require that we treat things that are different in the same ways. So if you're a professor and you're grading students, you don't have to give them all the same grade. You have to give all the students who write good papers a good grade, all the ones who write mediocre papers a mediocre grade, students who write bad papers a bad grade.
You haven't seen our curve at GW, but go ahead.
Well, here at Villanova, they don't believe in grading papers. So what do they mean? You'd be violating grade equality if you gave bad students good grades, or if you gave good students bad grades. But you don't violate grade equality by not giving them all the same grade. So what does this look like on marriage? It says that you have to treat all marriages in the same way, but you don't have to treat non-marital relationships in the same way. I'm not married. My roommate and I are not being denied marriage equality by not treating our relationship as a marriage. The Augustinian monks here, not married, they're not being denied marriage equality by not recognizing their relationships as marriages. Business partners, they're not married to each other. They're not being denied marriage equality by not having their relationships recognized as marriages. Same question here would be for throuples, three-person couples. The throuple is the technical term for a three-person relationship. Take three consenting men. They live with each other, they love each other. So here you don't have any concerns about patriarchy, any concerns about female subjugation. You just have three guys, live with each other, love each other. Their relationship's not being recognized as a marriage. Are they being denied marriage equality? On my account, they're not. Because while they're free to live that way, the three of them are free to love each other, to sleep with each other, to have a joint checking account, to be power of attorney for each other at the hospital, visitation, all that, liberty interest, free. They're not being denied marriage equality because the nature of their relationship isn't a marital relationship. Why isn't it a marital relationship? Because there's no act that will unite them as one entity in a comprehensive way. There's no act that orders that relationship towards the creation and then the rearing of new life. And there's no principled reason why they ought to pledge permanence and exclusivity to each other. Of course they can. The threesome can pledge to be a permanent throuple and to be an exclusive throuple, but there's nothing inherent in the nature of the relationship that calls for those commitments. That's how I understand what marriage equality requires and why. It's what I understand the founders to be talking about when they talk about, they have two types of equality. One's a political equality, which is simply that none of us was born with a saddle on our backs or wearing spurs. So therefore, there is no form of natural aristocracy. There's no form of natural hierarchy in terms of political leadership. We're all equal politically, which means we have to, as we the people, pass laws that we consent to govern our common lives. And then there's a second type of equality, that the laws that we pass have to treat similarly situated couples, individuals, businesses, students in similar ways. And so I don't think there's anything wrong with treating all marriages in a marital way, all good students with good grades, mediocre students with mediocre grades, all certain types of nonprofits in one way, but for-profits in a different way. Equality doesn't mean we treat everything the same, is that we treat similarly situated groups in similar ways. Thank you.
I'm trying again. I hadn't heard thruple before. I thought that was a Star Trek thing, but those are trebles, right? let me, first of all, I don't want to get into the mechanics of sex because this is a distinguished university and I was raised Catholic. But I'm not too sure what it means that heterosexual couples can join in a comprehensive way. I think same-sex couples would say they actually can comprehensively join. Once again, I don't know what that means, to join in a comprehensive way, but I have a feeling it's a fig leaf for what is the real reason. It is not the mechanics of sex, which I think the distinctions become rather hard to draw. It is indeed the procreation argument, which Ryan has returned to repeatedly. You notice he doesn't talk about the fact that people get married all the time that do not wish or cannot procreate. This is something that the court has repeatedly noted, that we don't require procreation or the ability to procreate as a condition of marriage. But what Ryan is doing is very creative, and he is very persuasive and creative, but it's a sleight of hand. That is, he's saying, look, I'm just treating equal things that are equal in equal ways. And that's just not the case with same-sex marriage. That is, we have to look at things that are equal. It's not equal to say that a black and white person can marry. That's because those things, because they are, you know, that they cannot marry, because they are equal. They're a man and a woman. What he's doing is he's picking the criteria to measure equality by. And it's a sleight of hand. See, I look at the same couple, whether they're black or white, or whether they are of the same sex, and I see equality, because I see two people who are coming to the government and saying, we want to be recognized as a couple legally. We want to be able to do all the things a legal couple can do. We are comprehensively united, whether that's physical or legal. We want to be recognized in that fashion. To me, those are equals, right? Because I don't think gender is any more relevant than race. So what Ryan says is, first accept the conditions of equality, and then we can all say that everyone's equal, even though we're treating millions of people as unequal. Okay? I would suggest that that is fundamentally wrong. When he says, why do you bring up loving? It's because the arguments you just heard from Ryan are identical to the arguments made for loving. The arguments back then was that interracial couples were immoral, that they produce children that become wards of the state, that they are unstable as relationships, and all of those reasons constitute social harm. And we eventually grew up as a nation and said, that's wrong. That is, these people were looking at that couple, they did not want to recognize their marriage. But there were two people who wanted to be recognized as married, just as same-sex couples do today. Now, when Ryan says, well, when you talk about equality, why are you bringing up Lawrence and criminalization? Because once again, if you look at Lawrence v. Texas, if you look at Hardwick v. Bowers, the briefs back then were the same arguments being made now. Is whenever we come to the Supreme Court, you have this shifting justification, but it's not much. That is, beneath the surface remains one simple and clear truth, and it was evident in Ryan's first discussion of Judeo-Christian values. That is, regardless of what veneer you put on it, Ryan is arguing for the right of a society to declare some people as legitimately married and some people as not, based on our moral beliefs. And so what I would suggest to you is that the government can get out of the business of enforcing moral codes. That we don't need to be told by the government what is moral. And we can start recognizing people who want to be married as a legal entity, not as a moral entity. And the 50% of people who divorce, who actually fit the description of Ryan, it didn't help them much. The problem with divorce and children without parents is a broader social issue. It wasn't the license that they got, or more importantly, the license that could not be received by other couples that produced those figures.
Why don't we, in the interest of dialogue, let you go next, Ryan, and right. We'll do a 2-minute closing argument so that we have plenty of time for Q&A.
Sure, so let me just say, I never used the phrase Judeo-Christian values. I haven't made any religious arguments at all. I haven't even talked about religion this afternoon.
You talked about the Hebrew faith.
I mentioned that the Hebrew Bible uses a phrase that reveals something true about human nature. But I never used the phrase Judeo-Christian values, nor have I made any moral arguments at all. So it's fascinating that this afternoon, every time we hear something about morality or about Judeo-Christian values or about religion, it's come from the professor. He wants to characterize this debate as one between legal equality and backward religious superstition. The reality here is that there are two different visions of what marriage is. One vision that I have defended, and one vision that has simply gone unarticulated and undefended. It's that vision of marriage that informed our divorce reform 40 years ago that has led to 50% of all marriages ending in divorce. What the professor fails to tell you is that it used to be that in America, you would file for divorce with cause. You would cite the grounds for your divorce. Marriage was then redefined the first time to eliminate the expectation of permanency. Because marriage should last as long as the love lasts, was the popular slogan from the 60s. So with no-fault divorce, you could abandon your spouse for any reason at all without your spouse's consent. One of the first times we redefined marriage to say, oh, it should be whatever we want it to be. The consequences of that, now about half of marriages end in divorce. Divorce rates more than double in the decades after the introduction of no-fault divorce. Now we're saying, and we heard the professor say this very clearly, that sexual difference between man and woman is just as irrelevant as race is. Which is surprising, because if I went to the bathroom earlier, he and I both went to the men's room. We didn't go to a whites or a colored washroom. So clearly, sexual difference between male and female matter in a variety of ways in which race does not. And clearly it matters with respect to the ability of two individuals, a man and a woman, to unite and create children, irrespective of their race, and then attach that child with a mom and a dad, irrespective of race. So the idea that I'm making the same arguments that the racists made to defend the bans on interracial marriage is simply not only ludicrous, but it's insulting. I mean, it's downright insulting for the professor to suggest Ryan is making the same arguments that the racists made. And it should have no place in civilized discourse.
That's true.
All right, let me be more insulting.
Do it in a civil way.
In a very civil way, okay? I won't trump this. I'm willing to accept bathroom privileges if you leave the wedding privileges to the rest of society. The argument that, look, we go to the men's room and therefore we must be able to confine the definition of marriage, I think is rather frivolous. Okay, I don't see the similarity there. Because once again, Brian is saying, look, you have to use my criteria. Stick with my criteria. Men and women are anatomically different. And since he's repeated that often, I guess I should have said at the beginning, and I'm sorry, I agree, okay? Men and women are anatomically different, okay? There we have it. It's irrelevant. It's irrelevant to the legal institution of marriage. Now, it's true, I have been unfair to Ryan, because I thought he was a religious warrior and said he's a cultural warrior. Apparently, he wants to go back to the 1950s. That is, we'd be much better back in the Ozzie and Harriet time when people actually couldn't get divorces. Did I hear that right? That you've got a problem with no-fault divorces? So we're going to go back now and say, you know, you got to convince us that you're ready for a divorce. Does that track? Is that where we are as a country? But more importantly, the whole Ozzie and Harriet period? Yeah, it looked like everyone was Ozzie and Harriet because we used to criminalize immoral acts. But we weren't any more moral in that sense. We were just as pluralistic back then. It's just that we forced people to look like us. We told them that they had to act like us, that we weren't going to extend the privileges of government to them unless they accepted our definition. And the idea that somehow, because of this, we have all of these social problems, no. We don't have those problems. Those problems are rising with people who are married, who meet his criteria. Just saying that you have to meet my criteria and the world will be better is a frivolous argument.
Which is why I didn't say it. I mean, you can rephrase my arguments in a way that make them sound frivolous. I mean, we can both do that. That's not particularly helpful for an audience of students that's trying to learn. Because the way that philosophers debate the ideas is actually saying, well, what are the arguments, the best arguments on both sides? What are the strengths and the weaknesses? It's not how can I rephrase someone's argument to make it sound ridiculous.
So Ryan,
that's not particularly helpful.
So
let's go back to the idea of, you know, your problem is not just with marriage, right? Your problem is with no-fault divorce, right?
Yes, I thought I made that very clear. So I think we needed the divorce reform back in the 60s. The type of divorce reform that we got was not particularly good, which is why the states that are now reforming the divorce reform and are showing good progress are not just having a quick and easy no-fault divorce regime. They're saying, let's put in waiting periods. Let's do voluntary skills training, which will teach people who might not have ever learned conflict resolution skills how they can work through a tough patch in their marriage rather than prematurely calling it quits. Those states are actually having remarkable success at lowering their divorce rates. So yes, I do think the regime of divorce reform that we got, no-fault divorce, was bad. That doesn't mean I want to turn back the clock to the 50s and Harry and Ozzie, right? That sort of parodying of my view isn't very helpful. What it does is it makes the viewpoint look ridiculous, which is why no one actually holds it. So it's a good debating point if you're on CNN. It's not a good educative point if you're trying to teach students.
Okay, let me put it this way. What I heard from you, and I may be wrong, because I'm beginning to wonder exactly what either of us have said, that we're entering a parallel universe, in that...
It's all being recorded, so YouTube will tell us what we've said.
What I heard was that somehow that we can achieve equality, so long as it's equality on my terms, that it's based on physical differences between the two couples, and whatever you mean by being able to join in a comprehensive way, okay, we'll let that go. But you also think that we need to roll back the clock to make people satisfy the state when they want to get divorced, which I find incredibly offensive. With what you may have faith in politicians in the state, but I don't want to be able, Republican or Democrat, to have my relationship defined by some bureaucrat to go into a clerk's office and, you know, I just don't think you're ready for a divorce. Explain to me why you're ready for a divorce. Let's have some constructive lessons here. We're going to have some other bureaucrats sit down with you to see how your marriage is going to work. I find that incredibly offensive. Anyone who's been to the DMV can imagine how nightmarish that is.
Which is why it doesn't work that way. So again, if you parody the view, you can make any view look ridiculous and offensive, but it's not very helpful for actually teaching students. So I guess the question just becomes, what do you want to do for the rest of the time we have here this afternoon?
Let me ask the question this
way.
Well,
we can't get married.
Let me ask the question this way. Jonathan, would you agree with Ryan?
No.
That on the question of divorce, the no-fault divorce, leave the state out of it for a moment. Would you agree that the question that the no-fault divorce, not having to give any reason at all, has weakened the institution of marriage in such a way that it's hurt the family world? Leave the state out of it. Just your opinion on that.
Well, I guess I'd have to answer that first one. In terms of whether it's weakened it morally, I couldn't possibly answer that because I don't see how the moral compass is defined, how you define morality for all these other groups.
Has it weakened marriage?
Now, that I would love to answer.
In such a way that it's hurt the family?
No. And I'll tell you what, I've seen the studies that say, look, as divorces have become more common, we've had more social problems. The fact is, I think requiring people who do not want to be married to stay married for periods produces other problems, like spousal abuse, like beatings, like crimes. You know, we have to, I know this is a hard thing to accept, but we have to accept that adults have a right to decide between themselves that they don't want to live together, and that's not a healthy marriage. I think that the marriages that survive under no-fault divorces are good marriages, because there's nothing holding you to the marriage. You can be divorced if you want to. And the ones that want divorce, I think they should be allowed to have divorce. Why? Because they're individuals, they're adults. And having the state say, we're just not ready for you guys to go separate, I find it enormously offensive.
I think that this is partly where the rubber hits the road here and the distinctions that are being made that have to do with, so the one question is, what about the family? And then the second question is, what is the state's proper involvement in that? I'll give you a chance to respond, and then we're going to go to questions from the audience.
Sure. So any type of government regulation where you want the government to be regulating the sexual lives of consenting adults needs to have conditions of entry and the nature of the exit. So all we're debating about is what are those conditions to entry for the marital relationship that the government's going to be regulating here, and then what would be the conditions for exit. Now there are all sorts of contracts that consenting adults form And there are various processes under which they will be litigated should there be a conflict and they want to end that contractual relationship. The question here is, what should it look like when spouses want to end their marital relationship? One vision was that you have unilateral no-fault divorce, where one spouse can divorce the other spouse without citing grounds for the divorce, without citing cause, and without getting the consent of their partner, more or less immediately. Other conceptions have been, look, you're not going to force them to live with each other. You're not coercing people to live with each other. So there won't be beatings or anything. No one's in support of that. You're not going to say they can't divorce, but you're going to say this isn't going to be a rubber-stamped process. We're going to have either a waiting period, or we're going to have, on a voluntary basis, again, no coercion, the option to sign up for conflict mediation, relationship skill building class, things to do to encourage people to live out the original commitment that they made to each other. Because the reality is that not always when you're in the heat of a moment are you thinking clearly, and are you making the best decisions. So when you signed up for a till death do us part marriage contract, when you signed up for a marriage license, rather than something
isn't it
else.
A marriage license? You don't agree to death to be part of the marriage license. It's you agree to be married. That's a religious ceremony.
No, so the marriage license is going to be an open-ended contract. So it's not a wed lease. There are some attorneys who propose that we should have wed leases in addition to wedlock, an expressly temporary marriage license that would expire after 5 or 10 years.
Who's
the way so I mean, this was a law professor writing in the Washington Post 2 years ago. So if you want to call one of your colleagues frivolous, that's fine. I'm actually reporting on the ground proposals for divorce reform. And so this lawyer's idea was, why, rather than having divorce, sign up for wed lease, a 5-year or 10-year marriage license, which then you'd have to renew to make it open-ended and lasting forever. The alternative, if you have wedlock, is that it's supposed to be till death do you part. There's a reason why, if you run through trouble in your marriage, it may not be the best thing for you, for children, for society, if you're granted an immediate divorce. And there may be ways non-coercively in which the state can help promote the permanent aspect of the marriage license. That's all the disagreement is here. It's a reasonable disagreement. We have great people thinking about how to reform divorce law, and we shouldn't just write it off as something that's crazy and ridiculous and morally offensive. I think that does injustice to the nature of this debate.
Okay. And everybody's going to behave, or I'm calling my husband. questions from the audience. I'm going to start with Jay McAndrews.
I'm a product of Ozzy and Harriet.
Stand up, please, Mr. McAndrews.
From the 50s. And I think the dilemma for us, our age group, is not as much government as it is reconciling Catholic tradition with secular divorce. Usually Catholics feel like in order to divorce you need annulment. You don't get that from the state. You must get that from the church. So when you discuss the state issues when it comes to marriage versus the religious issues, I think that's where many of us have trouble in the conflict. Could you address that?
I'd be delighted to. I'm Catholic, and the fact is that I think that your excellent point really makes the case. That is, for Catholics, to be divorced, you require an annulment. Your relationship with your faith, your relationship with your spouse within your community is defined by your moral institution, which in this case is the Catholic Church. The dynamic with the state is different. The state's interest is to determine who is still contractually obligated to them, who is legally the same, who is going forth as a couple. And that's a different dynamic. And so, yes, it's the same with divorce. There are plenty of Jewish couples that can get a secular divorce, but they are not recognized as a divorce until you get a get, until you get the other party to agree. That is left to you, is left to your community. But in terms of society, we have a narrower interest. And the reason it's narrow is because, of course, there's a host of different religions in our country. And like this one, they differ between the Jewish faith, the Catholic faith, the Muslim faith. You say 3 times, I'm divorced, and you're divorced. They all are different moral strictures and different conditions that define your family and your faith. But from our perspective, as a pluralistic nation, We're only concerned with your legal status and whether you are married. And we should keep that as objective and as defined as possible. And I believe I offered that more than Ryan.
So I think we actually agree on this, that the reason the state's in the marriage
business... Can I withdraw that comment?
Yes. You opened by saying you agree with my entire opening 5-minute talk, which explained what a comprehensive union was.
I was being peevish.
I noticed. I think we agree here in saying that the state's not in the marriage business because of the sacred or religious aspects of marriage. The state's in the marriage business because of the natural aspects of marriage. This is why the government's not in the baptism business, it's not in the bar mitzvah business. But the government is in the marriage business, which means it needs to have a definition of marriage. So it needs to know what marriage is, it has to define it accurately, and it needs to explain why it's in this business. The government's not in the best friend business. The government's not in the roommate business. Why is the government in this business? And I think here you have to look at the nature of marriage. Why is it looking at marriage not as a religious institution, a sacramental institution, a sacred institution, but as a natural institution? This is the institution that unites men and women as husbands and wives to then be mothers and fathers to their children. If this isn't what gets the government involved in the marriage business, we would simply get the state out of our bedrooms and we would only have private contracts between consenting adults of whatever size or shape that consent comes in. So I don't think we can actually have the halfway house that the professor is suggesting here. I think it either needs to be the state looks at the truth about the nature of marriage and then legally recognizes that truth about marriage, or the state simply gets out of the marriage business. But we can't have this halfway hybrid of just saying every couple will be recognized, and perhaps every throuple, and perhaps wed leases. It simply dissolves marriage into contract law, which is where things are going.
Yes. I'm also pausing.
Could you stand up?
Yes, I'm also pausing. I'm 64 years old, great, 12 years of Catholic education. And your talk about the problems with children not having a married husband and wife, I don't see how. The fact that if you let more people marry, and people who love each other marry and raise children, I can't see how that adds to the heart. And what if people have two loving mothers and two loving or two loving fathers, which nowadays, with the way our families are, it used to be the mother stayed home. That's not how it is anymore. So why not just let people have two loving mothers who are married, two loving fathers who are married?
Yep.
How does that harm each other?
Great.
Did everyone hear the question?
So the big question is, how does redefining marriage cause any of the harms that I talked about? Because I mentioned that it's not gays and lesbians who are to blame for the breakdown of marriage, it's heterosexuals who are. But the next phrase that I said was very important. It's heterosexuals who bought into this liberal ideology about what marriage and family is. And that liberal ideology is what we've heard this afternoon from Professor Turley, right? It's the idea that marriage simply is whatever consenting adults want it to be. So redefining marriage, it works like this. We get a bad philosophical understanding of what marriage is from the sexual revolution. For 40 or 50 years, heterosexuals lived that out with the hookup culture, with no-fault divorce, with non-marital childbearing, with cohabitation. They make a mess of exclusivity, monogamy, and permanence. Then the question becomes to the Supreme Court, well, does sexual complementarity matter all that much? If we've already have taken monogamy, exclusivity, and permanence and thrown out the window, what's the big deal about complementarity? The court says, oh, it doesn't matter either, which then further enshrines the consenting adults should do whatever consenting adults want to do, philosophy of marriage, into our law. The law shapes our culture shapes our beliefs, and then our beliefs will shape our actions. So as more people come to believe that their own marriage is simply what Professor Turley has said this afternoon, that it's simply whatever they want it to be, that it doesn't require monogamy or exclusivity, or permanency, that those are optional adds-on if they should desire them, but there's nothing about the marital relationship as such that requires them, we can expect that fewer people will actually live out those norms. What we know, though, is that those are the norms that actually make the difference for communities about marriage. It's not just that we need people to be loving each other, what we need is people to be in a monogamous, exclusive, permanent relationship, because that is the relationship that actually will prevent fatherless children and fragmented families. So the idea here isn't that this is going to somehow lead to more same-sex loving homes, and that's the problem. The idea here is that redefining marriage impacts it for everyone. And the best way to show that is right now, in many parts of America, it would be considered hate speech to say a child deserves both a mother and a father. So the second part of your question was, why aren't two moms or two dads good enough? And again, it assumes that men and women are interchangeable, that mothers and fathers are replaceable. it assumes that the only difference here is in how we go to the bathroom, to refer to Professor Turley's earlier response here, that sex is no different than race except for some anatomical differences. What the social scientists show is that mothers and fathers are different. They interact with children in different ways. And it has nothing to do with gender stereotypes or who stays at home or who goes to work. It's just that men are different than women. Men tend to do certain things with their children. Women tend to do certain things with their children. And children tend to do best when they have both. It's just recognizing the reality that we're not an androgynous species. Some species are androgynous. We're not. We do have sexual differentiation. Men and women are different. Mothers and fathers interact with children differently in a way that matters for those children.
Jonathan.
Well, I didn't peg you as a Woodstock reefer smoking hookup culture warrior, but apparently you're just fighting for some alien androgynous race. Let me just pull out a couple of things. First of all, what Brian referred to as the hookup culture was exactly your point. That is, if you don't want a hookup culture, how about supporting people who want to get married? They don't want to hook up. They want to raise children. They want to have good homes. They love their children. You notice you weren't answered to that. We have lots of children who want to be adopted, you know, who can't find loving families. And there are same-sex couples who want to give them a loving home. But, you know, there's an effort to bar that. But I'll point out two other things, and then we'll go to another question. One is, I don't know where Ryan is talking about. We're saying that a marriage should be between a man and a woman is hate speech. There are places around the world, but not in our country. We have free speech. So suggesting that somehow we're going down that road, I hope that's not true, because we would have to change our constitution.
No, people are calling.
People can call things hate speech.
Right, so people can call it. So what difference does that make?
That's what I said. I said in some places in this country, saying this would be called hate speech.
Okay, well,
so the First Amendment is utterly irrelevant.
All right, and in some cases, saying that it can be two women and two men might be called hate speech. What does that matter? There's wing nuts everywhere. But
I'm talking about like Harvard and Yale Law School. I mean, if you want to call those places wing nuts.
Oh, believe me, I would. For those two schools. But I want to note one more thing. And that is, you heard Ryan say, look, laws, I think I'm getting this quote right. Laws shape culture. Culture shapes our beliefs. Our beliefs shape actions. Okay? Now, I don't want to read too much into this, but what beliefs are sounds to me like our moral choices, what we believe to be correct. Ryan keeps on saying, I'm not here about morality. I just want you to have a relationship like the ones we think are right. But when I say right, it's not moral. We're just saying it's right because the other relationships, they're harmful. Okay? This is the relationship that I've been arguing has existed throughout all these cases, that law shapes culture, culture shapes beliefs, beliefs shape actions. That's the siren call that we have faced at every one of these stages as people have tried to dictate to us what a loving relationship is, what a marriage is, what's a permissible family union is.
Okay, question from a student. Yes.
Hi, my name is Smith. I'm in Professor Sheehan's class. I argued for your point of view just 2 days ago, so I watched your lectures and read some of your work. And one of the questions that I kind of like had was, you know, if we believe the social science that's there for like the last 40 years, that the best way to raise a child and for them to reach their full potential is to, you know, have a biological mother and father, have a stable relationship, and not have divorce. So it's hypothetically, if America were to go back to, you know, like a lower divorce rate by implementing divorce reform, by instituting a marriage, like your definition of a biological mother and father, would you be morally against a throuple adopting and raising a child?
So a throuple?
Yeah.
So, I think the basic idea here is that, as far as I know, there are no laws that are preventing three people from adopting a child. That's not illegal anymore. The question is, will adoption agencies, one, be free to seek out married moms and dads? In several jurisdictions, that's actually illegal. So I don't know what Professor Turley is talking about when he's saying that with the new move afoot is to prevent gays and lesbians from adopting. What's actually taking place is that faith-based adoption agencies are being forced to shut down in Massachusetts, in Illinois, in San Francisco, and in D.C. where we both work, because they simply want to be free from government coercion to seek out married moms and dads to care for children. I don't know of any state that would say three people couldn't adopt a child. I don't think that would probably be in the best interest of the child. Right? And I think what's going to be in the best interest of the child is to replicate as closely as possible what the child lost that placed the child in a situation of being an orphan in the first place. So what most people suggest in terms of adoption policy is to try to replicate the home that the child had lost as a result of being orphaned. And that's going to be trying to find a married mom and dad for that child to be kind of surrogate mothers and fathers, to be adoptive mothers and fathers for the natural mother and father who, for whatever reason, couldn't live out that.
What I would suggest that the child lost was a loving set of parents. Down the street from me, we have a couple, two women, who have such an adopted teenager. And he's thriving, and he has a loving home. And they would do anything for him. And they have been there at every stage. And he got what he lost. He got a loving home. And the idea that somehow we should look through a lens of this bias, look at them because they're the same gender, and say, well, there's something missing. There's nothing missing for him. That boy is having a successful life. He's a wonderfully well-adjusted individual. And we should celebrate that. In terms of faith-based organizations, I've actually argued in favor of faith-based organizations being able to specify as to being able to do adoptions that would exclude same-sex couples, even though I disagree with it. I believe that they do have a free exercise right to do that. And I think that we can tolerate that. We can have organizations that carry out their own guidelines in this sense, even if they receive some support from the state. So that is a red herring. Finally, in terms of states that bar same-sex couples, we've had probably two dozen cases in which this has been litigated. There has been an effort to bar same-sex couples from adopting. They have been unsuccessful, but it has taken about 20 years to turn that corner. But there are dozens of these cases, and there are still people arguing that it should be limited for the same reasons as marriage.
So let me just say two things in response to that. One, it's not a red herring to point out that while the professor and I agree about this issue, many people disagree with us, and enough people disagree with us that in four different jurisdictions, Catholic charity adoption agencies have been shut down. Right? So it's not a red herring to point out that not everyone is as reasonable as he is on this particular issue. It's a reality that there are activists out there who are trying to actually limit the number of adoption providers who are out there simply because they think kids do best with a mom and a dad. The second thing to say is that, you know, he mentioned an anecdotal story. There are lots of other stories that we should be equally aware of. And there were several of these now adult children of same-sex couples who filed amicus briefs at the Supreme Court. And what they said is that we were raised by true mothers. We love our true mothers, but the best second mom in the world can't replace a missing father. One of them, Heather Barwick, said, I was in favor of same-sex marriage because I wanted my true moms to have the right to marry. She had a vision of marriage similar to what we've heard this afternoon. She said, it was only after I got married to a man and I saw how my husband was fathering our children that I witnessed what I had missed out on by not having a father. And I was finally able to articulate what I had felt in my gut as a child but never knew how to express in words. And so she said that redefining marriage creates an institution for missing parents. That with single parenting, divorce parenting, no one encourages this. No one incentivizes it. We don't create institutions for single parenting and divorce parenting. We recognize their realities. We're a flawed, fallen species. We can't always live up to our ideals, but we don't create institutions for them. She said, with this, redefining marriage, you would actually be creating more children like being denied either a mother or a father on the philosophy that men and women are interchangeable and therefore mothers and fathers are. She says that goes against her lived experience, both as a child and as a mother, watching her husband father their children.
Yes, sir.
This is a question.
And you're next.
Professor, I followed most of what you said, and could understand it was very clear. There was one part that felt weak enough to me that I thought I must have misunderstood what you said, but I was clarified.
So stand up, please.
Stand up?
Yeah, we can hear you better.
So the basic premise of your argument was, look, justice and individual rights and fairness require us not to tell people what counts as a marriage. Requires us to respect their choices about what makes a marriage. And then when Ryan came back with the point about your own clients who aren't getting marriage recognition for a multiple partner relationship. You said, well, but that's an administrative burden. And I just don't understand that. So I'm under several contracts to cell phone providers and to law schools and loan servicers. People can have similar titles to property. As long as you have to register them, there's no administrative cost. So I guess I'm wondering, what affirmative purpose do you think gets the state into the marriage business in the first place? And how does recognizing multiple partner relationships or polyamorous relationships undermine that?
No, I thought I made it clear. I may have been too quick in the fog of frenzy of this discussion. What I said was that, first of all, I'm not saying that the state should simply declare any marriage, anyone who says that they are married, to be married as long as they're consenting adults. What I said was that in the issue of plural marriage, the states can make a case that there's a rational basis for denying multiple marriage licenses to a family like the Browns. And as I just said recently to the 10th Circuit, you know, I'm not going to prejudge that, but there are different rationales there.
I guess I'm asking you what you thought.
Yeah, but let me just close the circle now. But there are different rationales there than with criminalization. Now, I'll note that the state of Utah, in the course of our trial below, gave up arguing that plural relationships harm the state. They stopped arguing that, and they did not put on evidence because they realized they could not. Because all the harms that they were pointing to exist with heterosexual families as well. And so after a long trial period, one of the most conservative states in the union said they were not going to argue harm. Now, as to my view, I'm not too sure what the administrative costs are. I would keep an open mind as to whether there could be plural licenses, but I'm not prejudging it in the sense that I could see a state coming in and saying, look, if we have an open number of licenses that someone can get, it puts a much heavier burden on the state and upon other individuals in dealing with them, because their status with regard to multiple people are treated as legally one. And that creates a series of impacts on laws that govern everything from driver's licenses to taxation. And I think the state can come in and say, you know, that there's a reason why we don't want that to happen. That's a very different question from saying, we just don't think that this type of union should be recognized because they're not physically compatible in a comprehensive way. That's very different.
Sure, but it's different, but it's also actually quite revealing. So the Chief Justice, in his dissent on the Obergefell decision, says that Kennedy randomly inserts the adjective true throughout his opinion, but never actually justifies why he's denying marriage equality to throuples. And so what we just heard here today was that we might want to deny someone their constitutional equal protection rights because of some hypothetical administrative costs that were actually defined as administrative harms, to put it within the J.S. Mill harm principle idea. Fundamental rights aren't the type of thing that we simply trade away for hypothetical administrative costs. If people have a fundamental constitutional right to marry the people they love, why shouldn't they, if they're the threesome, be given all the same legal rights and protections that we give to twosomes? What is your basis for monogamy once you get rid of male-female sexual complementarity? Because in the Western legal tradition, the way that we arrived at the number two was that it's one man and one woman who unite as husband and wife, and every child has one mother and one father. But if you say that's unconstitutional, that's irrational, that's bigotry, that's akin to racism, what is magical about the number two? What is your legal principle? And it can't simply be administrative costs, because we have all sorts of contracts, that have more than one business partner. You can have multiple business partners, multiple administrators at a university, multiple roommates, multiple contractors. What would it be? And I think this goes to the nature of the question, what would it be about the marriage contract that the administrative costs of having multiple people entering into the marriage contract couldn't be dealt with, and yet every other contract under the sun is not limited to two people? And we didn't hear an answer to that question, and that's why it's revealing.
I'm going to go to the next question, but Jonathan, you can double back. You
okay.
can respond to this question and answer that one as well.
Well, my question is very similar to the question I asked earlier, but so I share your skepticism of government intervention in whether it's marriage or the economy, whatever it may be. So I'm curious, what are the reasons that, which I think this question has been phrased earlier, what are the reasons that we give benefits or why we recognize marriages as such? From my standpoint, the main reason would be if two people are raising children together, whether it's tax benefits, et cetera, that's one of the reasons. I'm sure there are many other benefits that there are. So why do we give that if bearing children is a side, is not necessarily?
That's a great question. I mean, first of all, the primary reason for the recognition of marriage is that you are changing your legal status. You want to be treated as one. You want to be treated as one, as a family. There's plenty of people who get married that can't have children, right? I mean, those are marriages, right? They may be more physically compatible in the view of Ryan, but there are plenty of folks that can't have children, but we recognize the marriage because they are joining as one legally. So this has an effect on taxation, has an effect on scholarship, has an effect on lots of things that we do in terms of our contractual relations. And the government certifies that. It gives you a stamp on a piece of paper that says, yes, we are accountable for each other and we are one. Okay? That, I think, is the proper role of the government. But you'll notice that in the answer to the earlier question, Ryan, once again, did a really interesting sleight of hand. He said, why can't you answer the question of why these plural relationships would not pose harm to the state, okay, something along those lines. The answer is because in this country, the state has to justify limitations. The state has the burden. This idea that, you know, we can't accept your argument because you need to come up with a reason why you shouldn't be denied something other citizens have. We don't do that in this country. If the government wants to deny us based on some status right, the government has to come forward and say, this is the reason. And my answer to the earlier question was, there may be arguments on plural marriage. They're different from criminalization, where they can say, look, we do have a real administrative problem here. We have these dimensions, these contractual things. But it's the burden of the government to show that. And if they can show it, fine. Then you limit it to one license each. And I'm perfectly willing to accept that they can make that case. But it's their case to make.
Right. And so what I was asking was to see whether or not his argument leads to the recognition of plural marriages, not just to the decriminalization of plural marriage, if he could offer us that argument. It's the same thing that the questioner asked, the same thing that you've asked. So now three times he's actually refused to offer us that argument, which makes it seem like he might actually think there isn't an argument there. That, yeah, he's willing to believe hypothetically there could be an argument there, but he's not willing. So what the argument here is that once you get rid of the male-female part of marriage, you will see what the Chief Justice called Justice Kennedy out for, no legal basis for limiting marriage equality to couples and not extending marriage equality to throuples or to other arrangements of consenting adults who also want to be treated as one. If you think about his initial response to your answer, he said, marriage is about individuals who want to be treated as one. So the question is, why not three? Why not four who want to be treated as one? I can give an answer for that. He doesn't want to actually explore the philosophical concepts that underlie the nature of marriage, but that the reason that they should be recognized as one in law is that they actually do become one. That what the Hebrew Bible is talking about there is not just poetry or theology, it's actually revealing something true about human nature. That a man and a woman in that act truly become one. And the reason the state should take an interest in when they become one is that frequently 9 months later, it requires a name. And the government has an interest in making sure that new life is attached to the man and the woman who gave that life. Apart from that, I'm with you. I don't see why the government is regulating our love lives at all. And we would just take the state out of the marriage business.
This conversation is sure to continue outside of this classroom where there are refreshments for everyone. Please give, if you filled out the form, and I encourage you to do so, we'd love you to be part of the Ryan Center, come more than to Jay, if you want to stand for a visit to New York. Please please join me in thanking Professor Turley and Dr. Anderson for bringing